This morning, chapter 15, verses 5 through 7. May God, who gives patience and encouragement, help you live in complete harmony with each other, each with the attitude of Christ Jesus towards the other. Then all of you can join together with one voice, giving praise and glory to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. So accept each other just as Christ has accepted you. Then God will be glorified.
Thank you, Greg. Praise God. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. If there's no other requests, I don't want to leave anybody out. Don't want to leave. And I know there's how many have unspoken. Yeah. Several unspoken requests. But he knows. He knows exactly what's going on. Father, I come before you and I praise you, Lord. Praise you for all the answered prayers that we have petitioned you with, and Lord God, even the ones that haven't been lifted up verbally, Lord God. We praise you and we thank you, Lord God, for what you're doing in the lives of each individual here, Lord. Lord, we yearn, Lord God, for more of you. More of you in our lives, Lord God. We want to walk like you're right beside us. We want to think like you're right beside us. Lord God, we want to do the things that are right, Lord God, in your sight and in your eyes, Lord God. Walk in your ways. So we praise you and we honor you, Lord God, for what you're doing right now in this congregation and around the world. Lord God, there's wonderful things that are taking place. Miracles are taking place. Healings are taking place, Lord God, in every corner of the world. And not just in this little place, not in this, in just a little congregation, Lord, but all throughout the world, Lord God. And we praise you and thank you for what you're doing. I pray, Lord God, that your kingdom would be multiplied today. That, Lord, that people, Lord, would come to you and they would give their heart unto you, Lord God. That the people that don't know you, they would give their heart to you, Lord, and they would come to know you as their Lord and Savior. Lord God, and we would get to be together someday in heaven. Lord God, we just thank you for what you're doing. I pray for each and every individual here, Lord God, that has asked for prayer requests, Lord God, for healing to take place, for deliverance, Lord God, for the unspoken requests, Father God, for the mental, for the physical, Lord God, the emotional, whatever it is, Lord, that has been spoken today. I ask that you would just minister to each and every individual. For the healings that need to take place and the comfort in the hospitals, Lord, I pray that you would be with them. For the less fortunate, Father God, we have so much. We have so much, Lord. So I pray for the less fortunate also, Lord. The homeless, the needy, the hungry, the children that don't have anything, Lord. I pray for them, Lord God, each and every one, that you, your hand, would be up on them, Lord, and that you would guide them and direct them in your path, Lord. We love you. We thank you for each one that is here. We thank you for our worship team, Lord, that you've given the talents to these people, Lord God. We thank you for that, Lord God, because I know it is a good sound to you, Father, whenever we are singing and worshiping you, Lord God. It's all about you, Father. It's all about you. Father, I pray an individual prayer for my pastor here. I pray, Lord God, that you keep him, that you hold him, Lord God, that you strengthen his body, strengthen his mind, Lord God, that, Lord, you would comfort him in the times of need that he needs to be comforted. You will heal whatever needs to be healed, Lord. Walk before him. Prepare the path for him and his wife, Lord, as they get ready for a new adventure. Lord God, we pray for our new pastor, wherever he is. Yes. But I pray for my pastor right here, right now.
Yes.
I pray, Lord God, that you strengthen his physical, mental, and whatever emotional body. That, Lord God, please lift him up, Lord God. Keep him safe, Lord God, in every aspect of his life and his wife also, Lord. Esther, we love you, Lord. We thank you for what you're doing and what you're going to do today. Lord, we just want to bring glory to you as we start our worship right here. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. we're together again. Praising the Lord, we're together again. In one accord, something good is gonna happen. Something good is in store. We're together again. Praising the Lord, we're together again. Praising the Lord, we're together again. In one accord, something good is gonna happen. Something good. And soar with you. Your spirit leads me on in the power of your love. You are beautiful beyond description.
That guides my Just the news this morning, the tensions and the power struggles going on in the hearts and minds of men on the border of Ukraine, fighting over resources and control and desire to have what others have and never content with what you've placed in our hands. God, how we need you. How we need you. And I think, Lord, you know, that we in the church, we're not immune from that. I think of the time when you said you were going to be leaving this earth, and one of the first things that cropped up was your disciples fighting over who would be first and who would be best and who would sit closest to you. Oh, God, how we need you. How we need you to teach us, Lord, to be servants of all. To teach us, Lord, that the highest place of honor comes at the foot of those in need. To teach us, Lord, that the things you've placed in our hands are not for us alone, but are for the benefit of those you've placed in our pathway. To help us understand, Lord, that the more lightly we cling to things, the more you allow to pass through our hands. Oh, God. God, I'm thankful for this congregation right here, for this body of believers who understands that the path to your kingdom is through blessing the lives of others, through exalting those who are in need, through finding a need and filling it, through showing love to those who may have been cast out. God, thank you for a people who are yearning to understand your heart and your mind, and who have a great desire to draw closer to you. Lord, we thank you for the testimonies we heard this morning of your activity in people's lives. You, not only your word is alive and active and sharper than a two-edged sword, but God, you are alive and active among this congregation. You have met needs before we've expressed them. You have heard the cry of our heart when we haven't even verbalized. And God, what you have done is beyond our capability to understand. But we thank you, and we praise your name, and we give you the glory, because it's not because of us, it's because of you. And so, God, I just pray for your continued blessing upon this congregation, that as we continue to understand that the church takes place outside of these walls, as we continue to understand that you came to seek and save those who were lost, that, Lord, we would find ourselves living in the stream of your influence and your love. And so, Lord, as we once again take a look at your word today, there were words that you expressed to the disciples the last real time that you spent with them and said that you had some things that you wanted to share on your heart. And Lord, the words of a dying man. And so, God, may we pay close attention to what was upon your heart, and may it be upon our hearts as we live out the lives you've allowed us to live through your grace and forgiveness and mercy. And for that, we give you thanks and praise in the name of Christ. Amen. 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 Ushers are coming. We'll receive this morning's tithes and offerings. And Richard, appreciate that. And I just want to, you know, I really appreciate what Richard does here.
Yeah.
Yeah. He took over when I was when I went in the hospital. Got notified like at what 10 o'clock at night or 8 o'clock in the morning or what was it?
And just about 9:30.
Yeah, and just took over, and he's been doing the music since then. And I tell you what, Richard, I love you, I appreciate it.
Amen. Thank you.
But Richard does this in pain.
Yeah.
Yes, he does.
All the time.
Nerve.
Okay. He has a nerve pain that sometimes will not go away and will not allow him to sleep at night. And he's gone back into a cycle of that nerve pain right now. Okay? So we're going to pray for him before he sits down. Is that okay? Okay. I just want to anoint you, Richard, and pray for you. Father in heaven, we hold up Richard before you, your beloved child, your creation. We don't understand what's taking place, what's causing this, and Richard doesn't understand it either, and he's been trying to work on it, do everything that he can from his side, in addition to prayer and just whatever types of things may work to help him out, to relieve the pain and to be able to just get a little bit of sleep at night, a little bit of rest. But God, you created Richard. You know every fiber of his being. You know exactly what is going on. And so, Lord, today I am asking you for your healing touch to come upon your servant. That, Lord, he can just be one of those who would come on the Sunday morning and have that testimony that just like we heard from Wanda Replogle, that so many years of that knee hurting, and it's been so many years of Richard's brain hurting. And so, God, we're praying that he will wake up that morning and say, it's gone, it's gone. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you. We give you the glory. We give you the praise. And we thank you in advance for your touch upon Richard and the testimony that he is going to have because of your great love for your servant. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we anoint him and fill him with the power of your Holy Spirit. In Christ's name we pray. Amen and amen. 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 God bless you, Richard. Amen.
Come over.
Thank you.
You're going to be amazed.
Amen. Well, it's fantastic to have each of you here today, and those joining us online, we're happy to have you with us also. And I'm going to wrap up this series we've been going through. This is part three of a four-part series, so next Sunday. But we've been looking at the prayers of Paul recorded in Scripture, and so we're going to I pray as we've been going through this, okay? If you haven't been with us, you can go on YouTube, you can catch up online, but I pray that these prayers are becoming a part of your prayer life as in one way or another as we have gone through these. We're adding them to our prayer life because the reality is, for so many Christians I know, sometimes they have this question, I need to know how to pray. I have difficulty knowing what to pray, or, you know, so this is just kind of a help for us. So we're learning to pray for four things that Paul prayed for. So week one, we learned how to pray for power. So that Christ could dwell within us. And then last week, we learned to pray that we would be active in sharing our faith. And then when we learn to share our faith, we come to a full understanding of every good thing we have in Christ. Okay, so this week we're going to look at a prayer of the Apostle Paul that is very, very close to the prayer that Jesus prayed in John 17. You know, if Paul prayed it and if Jesus prayed it, then certainly it should be something we would want to pray for. Is that right? I mean, you know, those are some pretty good examples, I would think. And so the content of this prayer, it revolves around the idea of unity and unity with God also. Unity with the family of God, unity in the body of Christ. Because let's be honest, unfortunately, in today's world, Christians are not always the most unified people. Okay? I mean, and here we are. We're living in a country that could... I've never seen a time that our country has been more divided. So why do we want to be on board that ship? I mean, there's division in the church, there's division in the country. How many of you agree that's true? You know, there's a lot of division nowadays, okay? In fact, I have personally heard a lot of people criticize the church. I ask people, and they'll say things like, well, no, I don't go to church anymore, it's just full of hypocrites, okay? Yeah. Oh, they say, oh, no, the church has just become a big rock concert anymore, and it's not even up to good rock and roll standards, so why would I go to a bad rock concert? Yeah. Oh, church today is so shallow. All they do is they just preach about love, you know? And then I hear other people say, no, I don't go to church anymore. They just preach hate. In fact, you know, you won't hurt my feelings, but honestly, how many of you have ever heard people who have criticized our church or the church in general? How many of you ever heard somebody criticize the church? Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So just, you know, well, maybe hurt my feelings a little bit, but in fact, okay. I would agree with all of my heart that one of the one of our spiritual enemy's greatest schemes is to try and divide the body of Christ. And why would he want to do that? Because the thing is, if we are united, we are unstoppable in what we can do for the glory of God here on earth. I mean, but if we're divided, we're deluded and diluted, and we are weak. We are ineffective in being used in the way God would want to use us. And so today, I just want to dive into the prayer the Apostle Paul prayed that really addresses a very important theme of the family of God being unified. Why? So that we can glorify God. So if you want to glorify God, here is what Paul prayed. In Romans chapter 15, verse 7, 5 through 7, and Greg read this earlier, you know, here's his prayer. May the God who gives endurance and encouragement give you the same attitude of mind toward each other that Christ Jesus had. His prayer is, would you treat each other like Jesus would treat them? Would you think about each other like Jesus thinks about you? Would you love each other like Jesus loves you. He says, I want you to have the same attitude of mind as his prayer towards each other that Christ Jesus had. And then he says, why? So that, okay? The key in his prayers is so that with one mind and one voice, wow, you may. You read that with me? So that with one mind and one voice, you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Wow. Wow. And then he says in verse 7, and we'll come back to this verse, he says, accept one another just like what? Just like Christ accepted you. Wow. In order to do, he says, when you do this, here's what happens. It will bring praise to God. So, if you want to glorify God, if you want to bring praise to God, what we do is we treat each other the way Christ loved us. We accept each other as Jesus Christ has accepted and loved us. So that, why? So that we would bring glory to God. His prayer is just very, very consistent with the prayer that Jesus prayed. And I want to read this to you as well from John chapter 17, verses 20 through 23, where Jesus prayed. He said, I pray also for those who believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one. And then Jesus gives a so that. That all of them may be one, okay? We, as a family of God, that we would be one, that we would be unified. And then, you know, this is so good. It's just so good. Then the world will know that you sent me. Wow. God, I want them to do this. You sent me, God, for a reason. You sent me, and there's a so that there. There's a so that there. You sent me, Jesus said. Yeah. And I have loved them. It says, wow. God, I want them to have unity. I want them to have unity. I've loved them as you have loved me. Now, Paul prayed for unity. But why did Paul pray for unity? He said, so that God would be glorified. And the world would be known that God sent Jesus to reach out to them, a lost and a broken world. So, we've learned so far, what we're praying for as a church, we're praying week number one, we're praying for power, spiritual power. And then we're praying that we will be active in sharing our faith. But today we're going to add to our consistent prayer life, and this is part of what we as followers of Jesus are going to pray for the rest of our lives, okay? I hope you're praying for unity the rest of your life, unity for the body of Christ. Why? So that we can glorify God. And so the world will know that God sent Jesus for them. I ask myself, you know, I wonder why this is so important to God. Getting a little older, and Mark even talked a little bit in Sunday school class this morning about the difference of having, you know, being a grandparent and being a parent, and it is a little bit different, but of course, I'm the parent of two children and three grandchildren, getting a little bit older, and I really think I have a better understanding through raising children of what our Heavenly Father, why unity is so much, so important to Him, why He loves unity so much. In fact, I think for Esther and me, one of the things that brings the greatest joy is that our adult children actually have come to the place they love each other and they love us. You know, it's just so wonderful. That's not always been the case. I don't know about you, but man, the back seat of that car. Couldn't they make the back seats wider and put a wall in the middle or something like that? I mean, we'd go on some road trips, and it's just like, I mean, if you wanted a vision of hell this side of eternity, it was in the second row of that car. I found myself doing things I thought I would never do. I'd never do like that, you know. Don't make me pull this car over. You know, what's wrong with you? I'll pull this thing over right now. You know, and I'd be swinging away and hitting the wrong kid and all that kind of stuff, you know. And it just seemed to never fail. I mean, and I think of my kids, and, you know, they love each other. Why is it that we so often fight in the body of Christ? Tragically, I think some people think the Christians on the other side of the tracks here are our enemies. Or I don't know. It's only when we recognize we have a common enemy that we can be united. We need to recognize we have an enemy whose mission it is to steal and to kill and to destroy and to steal unity from the family of God, to kill the power that unity brings to the family of God, to destroy the credibility of the local church that stands up for Jesus Christ. And when we recognize His tactics and we stand together, oh, we can do infinitely more working together than we can do individually. That is why we pray that God would bring unity in the body of Christ. Why? So that God can be glorified and the world will know that He sent Jesus. Okay, so in order to motivate you even more to help this become an intimate, ongoing part of your prayer life, I want to give you three reasons to pray for unity, okay? Three reasons we pray for unity. And the first reason is this: we desperately need each other. Oh, man. We desperately need one another in the family of God. Paul said it this way to the Romans in chapter 12, verse 5. He said, just as our bodies have many parts, and each part has a special function, so it is with the body of Christ. In other words, the hand is not the ear, and the ear is not the foot, and all the parts really need to work together. They have a special function, and without each other, they are really incomplete. He said this. He said, we, meaning followers of Jesus, we are many parts of one body, the body of Christ. We all, you get that? Let's say it together. We all belong to each other. Wow. We're part of a broader family. And I, you know, the thing is, I mean, a different perspective. I don't know. I grew up out in the woods, you know, out in creation. I love diversity. And each part has its function. I mean, there is, you know, we're part of a broader family. We're different, I believe, by design. And we need to understand this about unity, and that is that unity is not the same as uniformity. Okay? We actually, there is much strength in our differences. It is our differences that gives us the ability to reach so many different types and groups of people. In fact, I asked you earlier how many of you heard somebody say something bad about our church or just question the church in general. And, you know, I could see, you know, almost everybody has heard something said about church, maybe, that was bad. Now, here's my sincere hope. My sincere hope is, you know, the last 25 years that I've been around here, though you've heard me, I disagree on some theological stances with, you know, some other denominations and other believers, and I'm vocal about the disagreements that I have maybe theologically, but I pray I haven't. I don't think you've ever heard me say that I wish another Christian denomination no longer existed or was evil or you know, if I slipped up and I've had, forgive me, you know, that is not, you know, I have purposed in my heart never to run down another group of Christians to elevate myself.
Amen.
I mean, now I want to confess to you that there was a time that I thought that was okay to put down others, you know, to make yourself look better. But, you know, what I could do easily, you know, is say, hey, you know, we're not like other churches. When you're here, you know, you'll get the truth. And other preachers won't tell you what I'm going to tell you. I'm just going to tell you the truth, you know. Why? Well, because, hey, I preach the Word of God, you know. At our church, we preach the Word of God. When we get into that, we're basically saying that we're better than other people because we tell it like it is. When I prepare to preach, I mean, I try to tell it like it is, okay? But I don't want to say, you know, well, we're not like those people over there who don't. We can do that in the church world. And sometimes it happens unintentionally. I don't know, like, well, we're not like that bad, boring church, you know. Well, what did we just do there? We just took a shot at somebody. Okay? We're not like the chosen frozen, you know. Yeah. We're not like those crazy charismatics, you know, slain in the spirit, falling on the ground, you know. We're not like those huge mega, you know. We're not like those small country. We're not like those seeker-sensitive church light, you know. Hey, where would we be going with that? Who cares what we're not like? Huh? We just want to be who Christ is calling us to be. I mean, be exactly what you are. You don't have to put someone else down. Just be what Christ has called you to be. Yeah, the reality is that chosen, frozen church is going to reach someone that maybe we can't reach, you know? The reality is that those crazy, you know, emotional, whatever, they're going to reach someone I can't reach. There's a spiritual power there that's going to talk to some people, okay? Those small house churches, they're going to be effective in ways that big mega churches can never be effective. So what we're going to do is we're going to say, I'm not going to put down other churches. Okay? In fact, I'm going to say it this way. If we're going to make a mistake, and I want this to be the posture of our church here. If we're going to make a mistake, we can only control what we do. Okay? If we're going to make a mistake, we're going to err on the side of being for other believers and not against them. Okay? If we're going to make a mistake, we're going to speak well of other Christian ministries. We're going to speak well of other Christian movements. We're going to speak well of other Christian denominations. What I'm not saying is, I will speak out against a blatant error. Okay? I'm not saying we won't call out blatant error. If someone says Jesus was a sinner, if someone says there's no such thing as hell or sexual immorality, you know, or hey, it's okay, you can get saved and just do whatever you want, you're guaranteed to go to heaven. I mean, I'm not going to let that pass. If it's something that will lead people astray from God's word, I will speak up about that and correct that. I'll be vocal about teachings that actually fall outside of the realm of historical Christian belief and the word of God. I'm talking about blatant error, okay? And we will correct that. We'll be vocal about those things, but we're not going to nitpick over, well, you know, they have contemporary worship and they should be traditional, you know. Why would we be picky about things like that when if you are even close to up to date with the news around the world, somebody's losing their head for saying they're a Christian? And we're going to pick over song selection? Come on, people. You know, we're not going to zero in on incredibly small things. I hope you heard the language I use. It's very intentional. You know, we do have brothers and sisters in Christ who are being beheaded for what they believe. But you need to understand, those people need us. They need us to be unified as believers. And I'll tell you this, we need them. We need perspective. We need to pray. We need to be aware. And suddenly, when we recognize we have an enemy is doing things like that to our own, all of a sudden we realize we're part of a much larger family. Followers of Jesus in Uganda, followers of Jesus in Nepal, followers of Jesus all over Europe, followers of Jesus in South Africa. I'm talking about from all over the world. Every nation our good God created. There are men, there are women, there are children. Some are rich, most are poor. They speak every different language you can imagine, from every ethnic background possible, from more denominations than we could even name, and yet all worship one name, and that name is Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. We need each other. Therefore, we pray. We don't just hope. We don't just wish. We don't just do nothing about it. We pray for power because we need power. We pray we will be active in sharing our faith so that we'll have a full understanding of every good thing we have in Christ. And we pray for unity in the family of God so that God would be glorified and the world will know that God sent Jesus. Why do we do this? We do this because we truly, truly, desperately need each other. And the second reason we do this is because we want the world to see God's love. When we're unified as a family of God, they see demonstrated an active, passionate love for Jesus Christ and for his family. In fact, I love the imagery of Romans 15:7. When Paul, along with his prayer, he said this, he said, "Accept one another just as Christ accepted you in order to bring praise to God." Accept one another like Jesus accepted you. In fact, you know, there's a big Greek word there, and I couldn't pronounce it, so I didn't even put it in your notes, and I try to pronounce it, I just butcher it. But it's a really picturesque word, and it's beautiful. It carries the imagery of when you accept someone, that you receive them into your arms, and you embrace them. And then it carries the idea of then you go from that and you just walk hand in hand with a brother or sister. So when you accept someone like Christ accepted you, I mean, I think of that and I go, well, how did Jesus accept me? Well, you know, for all of us, it's this way. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He didn't wait for us to be perfect. You know, it was before we had everything together. And that's why, that's what we need to do with other followers, okay? They may be different. And they're looking at us and they're going, boy, you're different, you know? And so, you know, a different style or a different focus, but we accept one another. We walk hand in hand. We walk together. We embrace one another. And when we do this, I'll tell you what, we could, man, I tell you, if we could get this going, we could change the reputation of the church. And man, I'm telling you, today it needs to change. Instead of the body of Christ, the church, the Christians, being known for what we're against, oh, they're against this, no, they're against that, no, they don't like it, they don't like that. Instead of being known for what we're against, then by the grace of God, we would start to be known for what we are for. We are for people experiencing the grace and the love of Jesus. And when the world could see this when we begin to love and accept one another. In fact, Jesus couldn't have said it more clearly. John 13, 34 and 35, you know, he said, I want to give you a new commandment. How about this one, people? Yeah? He says, oh, wow, what's this new commandment? What's he say? Love one another. Wow. Ooh. My, as I have loved you. You love one another. Wow. Now, watch this. 35, it's really powerful. Okay? It says this. By this. Okay? That's a so that. Okay? So that. Okay? Notice what he didn't say. He didn't say. He said it's because of your love for one another. He didn't say it's because of your doctrine. Did he? No, he didn't say that. Let's see. He didn't say, because of your denominational preference. He didn't say, because of the style of your music. He didn't say, because you read the correct version of the Bible. We all know those other losers are going to hell, right? So, no, what did he say? By this. You want to be known as a disciple of Christ? By this, by your love for one another. Yeah. Everyone will know you're my disciples if you'll just do this. There is only one description in all of the Bible. There is only one description of how the world will be able to tell you're following Jesus Christ. What is that one description? By the way you love one another. That's why we pray. We believe God hears and answers our prayers. We believe our prayers matter. We believe if we humble ourselves and seek our God and pray that He hears our prayers and He answers. We don't pray small, general prayers. We pray big, specific, faith-filled, passionate prayers. And it takes faith to pray for a divided church. Capital C, the church. Why do we pray for unity? We pray for unity because we need each other. We pray for unity because we want this world to see God's love through our unity. And a third thing is, with unity, we can just do a whole lot more than we can divided. Okay? We believe the local church is the hope for the world, and we can do infinitely more together than we can do apart. And quite honestly, we want to do everything we can to demonstrate unity. We want to do everything possible to support other churches. And one of the things we do is we ask how we can leverage what we do have in order to serve the broader family of God. I mean, if you come around here, okay, this Saturday is distribution, okay, food distribution. You come around here on a food distribution Saturday, you're going to see a very eclectic group of people working here. Okay? I mean, it's food pantry. We allow people of all faiths, you know, to come and to be a part. I mean, we even have one couple that's not, they're not even Christians yet, but they come and they help us out and they support the work of the church in general. And, you know, nothing would please me more in this community. Nothing would please me more than if the River of Life, the Church of the Brethren, the Catholic Church, were full to overflowing every week, and you had to fight to find a seat. And even if that happened here, you know what I'd love to see here in Layton? I'd love to see if the Methodists said, we got to go back to Layton. They don't have room to seat people in the churches out there. We need to turn that thing back into a church. I mean, I'd love that. It's our great honor to do infinitely more together than we can do apart. That's why the heartbeat and attitude that made the first century church thrive, think about it. What did they have? They had no buildings. They had no television. They had no radio shows. They had no fundraisers. They had no special campaigns. What did they have against them? They had massive persecution. They had people weren't just tweeting bad things about pastors. There were droves of people who were, you know, just looking to kill pastors. But there were a lot of people who said, hey, we're watching these people. We believe, you know. They believe Jesus is Lord. They think He's risen from the dead. They're a little band of uneducated, first century, passionate followers of Jesus Christ. And you know what happened? Because of their unity, the message of Jesus was spread all over the world. They were known throughout the community that said, well, we might not believe like they believe, but oh dear God, they love each other. You know, the way they stand together, the way they're united, I've never seen anything like that. I want to show you how it was described. Acts chapter 4, this is so beautiful. Luke described it this way. He said, all the believers were one. All the believers were one. No one claimed, one in heart and mind, wow. sometimes I wonder what that means, you know, to be all unified in heart and mind. No one claimed any of their possessions was their own, but they shared everything they had. I just pause there. Yeah, that's a crazy level of love, isn't it? That's just a crazy. I mean, that's next level love. I don't know that we understand that love. That's commitment to family of Jesus unlike anything. Yeah, I've rarely seen it. I rarely ever lived like that myself. And in fact, in another portion of Acts, it describes what they did. These crazy people, they loved each other so much. They would actually go out and, you know, sell a piece of land and just bring the money and dump it at the apostles' feet and say, hey, you know, whatever it needs, the church needs. And you know, we'll just trust you to just disperse it. And so if they saw a need, they'd get to whoever was in need. And then, you know, just a crazy unified love. And then verse 33, I mean, by the grace of God, God's grace was so powerful at work among them. It says God's grace is powerfully at work in them, so much so that there were no needy persons among them. Do you see what power can come from unity? Every need was met by God through the family of God when they didn't see themselves as individual Christians, but they saw themselves as family. They saw themselves as a part of a much larger picture and a part of a body that needs each other and that wants to demonstrate the love of God, that recognizes that they're to love each other. I mean, think about what the skeptics were saying. Think about if the church, even not even around the world, just if the, let's say just the church in California acted like this. Think about what people would say. Well, I don't know about this whole Jesus thing and that whole rise from the dead thing. I mean, I don't know about that, but oh man, do you see how Christians treat other people? Do you see how loving they are? Do you see how they forgive one another and don't hold grudges against each other? Do you see how they take care of their own and how generous they are with us who aren't even a part of their community? I'm going to argue this. I mean, all day long, I think the world is sick and tired of hearing about the love of Jesus. I think what the world needs is to see the love of Jesus. They want to see it. And how will they see it? They will see it in how we love one another. And that's why we pray. And we pray for unity. This is not a what benefits me prayer. This is a prayer for the family of God, so that we as a church, we pray for power, we'll pray for being active in sharing our faith, and we'll pray for unity in the family of God. Why? So that God will be glorified and that people will know that God sent Jesus. And what would happen? Oh, can you just dream? Can you just dream what is possible? What could possibly happen? Billions of believers. Every village, every city, every tribe, every nation of the world. If we stood together and said, what we have does not exist for us, it exists for the glory of God, what do you think we could do together? I just dream. What could we do together? I think I could argue all day long that if the desire of Jesus Christ and the desire of Paul's prayer were to come true for the church of today as a whole, by Monday, starvation would be eliminated around the world. By Tuesday, every person could have clean drinking water. that does not have access to it today. By Wednesday, poverty could be eradicated. By Thursday, everyone with a medical need would have their need met. And by Friday, all the orphans in the world would be in loving, caring families. And by Saturday, every person alive would have heard of the love of Jesus Christ. And the following Sunday, we would break bread and fellowship together because we are one body under one name, serving one God with one purpose, to bring His love and grace to a world that does not know it. And I believe this is possible. You know why it's possible? Because it is the will of God.
Yes.
I believe it will start right here.
Yes.
I believe it'll start when we as a church, when we pray, and when we stand together with other Christians, and when we don't take shots at each other, but we believe that God has called us to be a part of a larger family, a part of a higher calling, a part of a higher purpose, to serve our higher God. May He be glorified in all we say and in all we do. Father, may we be united. May we be one, that You would be glorified in the world and would know that You sent Jesus Christ. I ask, God, that by the power of Your Holy Spirit, You would lead our church to be a church that prays, that God, we would not wake up and, oh, what do we pray for today? But we would pray for power. We would pray for spiritual power. We need Your power, that Christ may dwell in us. And we need Your power to know how much You love us, to glorify You in everything that we do. And God, we pray that we will be active in sharing our faith, that people will come to know You and would have a full understanding of every good thing we have in Christ. And Father, I pray that we would pray for unity. I pray for each person here, for anyone who sees or hears this message online, even that this will become a part of their prayer life, certainly in the next 7 days. But Father God, there are 12 or 13 things I pray for all the time, and this is one of them. I believe, reflecting the heart of Paul and the heart of Jesus, that God, this is something we as the family of God should consistently pray for. And I pray, Lord, that each person here would at least agree to, for the next 7 days, to commit to pray for unity in Your church and in Your family, and then work toward that. We pray for unity, God. Father, I thank You. I believe You're speaking to hearts of each of us and showing us the importance to not only pray for unity, but to live unified. God, we can't control what others are going to say or do, but God, give us the opportunity to lead the way in showing unity. And God, help us to err on the side of being for other Christians and not assuming the worst. And Lord, help us to assume the best and to do whatever we can to do our part to partner with other believers around the world and in our own backyard right here, God. We especially pray for those who are being persecuted right now, those whose lives are in danger. God, we pray that by any means possible, You will protect them. And, you know, there are those who lose their lives in the name of Jesus, and we recognize those are our brothers and sisters. God, we know You count on them as heroes in the kingdom, and You count them as even more, God, as Your family. We will not sit by and do nothing. We will pray and believe that prayer is powerful, and we'll do whatever else is in our power to make a difference, because we're the family. We're Your body, the body of Christ. We know You've called us to stand together. God, make us so unified the world will see Your love in Your church, and that love will draw people to know Jesus Christ, and You will get the glory. We pray this in the name of Jesus and in the will of the Father. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Now, before you leave this morning, there's something else I want to say. You know, I need to share this with you. The seeds for what I had to say this morning were planted years ago when I first came to Hanford. I went with a group of pastors from the Sacramento district and this district to Atlanta, Georgia, to a Pastor's Promise Keepers conference. At that conference, I saw something that just blew my mind, and then I had one of the saddest times I've ever had as I watched what took place a little bit later. The thoughts were planted by a pastor from a different denomination, the Church of Christ, and he spoke there. His name is Max Licato. We come from different theological understandings. As you leave today, I want to give you each a copy that I copied from his book. It's called In the Grasp of Grace. It's a devotional book, and I'm going to give you a copy of chapter 16 of that book as you leave today, okay? He used a little bit of what I had to say today, and a part of that is in this chapter, not the whole thing that he presented at Promise Keepers, but a little piece of it. It was just a parable that he told because we were leading into a time of communion in this great arena that we were in with thousands and thousands of pastors. It was strange because we were going into a time of communion, and by the way, we're sitting here in a church of God, and just before he spoke, they had had a foot washing service, which included a pastor from the Indian nation who forgave a pastor from Mexico, who forgave a pastor from one of the families that came in and took over much of the Indian land in Oklahoma, who forgave another pastor, and they began to wash one another's feet, starting with the Indian washing the feet of the. And so Max Licato then brought us into this time in which he talked about the power of unity and fellowship, as I have today, but in a little different parable, and most of that parable is in the devotional I'll give you, where he compared the Christian church to the deck of a ship. And it was a really, really powerful time. But as many of you may know, the Church of Christ believes communion is only for members of the Church of Christ. And so when he finished his talk on the great need for unity, we went into a time of communion, and about 120 members of his church stood up and left and broke his heart. He was attempting through the Word of God to change the mind of his church, as I've attempted to maybe change some of your minds this morning. The desire of God's heart is and will always be that we are his army, okay? I said to several people up at retreat this past week that, you know, it's kind of like in the United States, we have the armed forces, okay? Army, Navy, Air Force, Marine, Coast Guard, yeah, we have. They each have a different job to do. And they bicker about who's best and who does a better job and that kind of thing. And they bicker back and forth, and that's great. But when they're at war, they each do their job. Or their brother gets shot. Or their other friend gets bombed. I want to tell you something, folks, this morning. In the United States of America, we're at war. Amen. Let's not be people who are taking the pot shots during a time of war. Amen? Amen. I'll give that to you on your way out, okay? Thank you for being here. God bless you.